Good afternoon, students. Yesterday we had seen the age of industrialization introduction part. Today we are going to see the second and third topic, the first one of which is hand labor and steam power. Now, before the age of industrialization, the work was done through hand, that we all have discussed previously. Now, when the industrialization broke out, at that point of time, a lot of people started moving to from countryside, they started moving to cities. So there was no shortage of labor in England specifically. But the other problem of laborers were that most of the industries were seasonal, which meant that only during certain period of time in a year they were employed. For example, as they have said, that during the peak time, the bookbinders, printers, catering to Christmas demand too, the people were, the workers were in demand. Like for example, at the time of waterfront, when the winter broke up, when the winter started, at that point of time, the ships were repaired and cleaned, which meant that during that time period only, a lot of employment was generated. But during the other time, the employment was hardly seen. So the life of worker was not as good as we have seen. Second point, the main point was during the Victorian Britain, the hand labor machines, the hand labor products were considered to be fine in quality as they were done with precision, whereas the machine made products were considered cheap and were not meant for the aristocrats. So that was another problem for the machine, for the workers working in machines or with the machines. They were bettered, finished, individually produced and carefully designed handmade products, whereas machine made products were good for exports only. Now let us see after this what was the life of worker. As I told you earlier, that the worker's life was affected. We'll see in the next slide, please. Next. Yes, yes, here you can see. The abundance of labor in the market meant that the merchants and the industrialists exploited workers by forcing them to work for cheaper wages, which meant that they were not given proper payment. The news of possible jobs traveled to countrysides and hundreds of workers traveled to the cities, as we have seen here. Tram to the cities, and mind it, the actual possibility of jobs dependent on existing network of friendship. For an example, a person already working in a factory, if you have the contact with that person, then it will be easy for you to get the job, or else it will be difficult for you to maintain the job security, or even to get the first job, it was quite difficult. Which means, at the same time, everyone did not have that social contact. So, a group of people were only benefited out of this network of job. Now, when I said that the life of workers was not good, then without work, what were they doing? Especially during the non-seasonal period, they had two options. Either to go back to the native place, that is to the countryside, and do the agricultural work, or they need to do some odd jobs to maintain their livelihood. But what was the effect of it? They were thrown out of the rooms which they rented at the time when they were fully employed, which meant that a lot of people or population were on streets. So there was a problem of even creation of rebellious activities in the city, specifically in cities like Leeds, Manchester and England, where the growth of industrialization was higher and the proportion of migrants was 9 upon 11, which meant out of every 11 person living in London, Manchester and Leeds were belonging to the countryside and were not the natives of the place. Next slide, please. Next. Next, here you can see the spinning jenny. This was one of the problems that workers faced. Spinning jenny had the capacity to employ or to take the employment of 20 workers. The work which was done by 20 workers at a time, the spinning jenny could do. Here you can see the spindles. This spindle work was individually done by one worker, and this spinning jenny systematically took job of 20 workers. And who were the hard hitters of this? By this, the women. Women were always the hard hitters, and they were replaced by spinning jenny. So women, probably for the first time, came out bursting in the society, came out bursting in the market, demanding the security of their job. Next slide, please. This is a very famous person, James Watt, as we know. We already discussed in the previous topic. Next. Next, please. Next, please. Next. Next. Already we have seen this. Next. Next. Yes. Now let us talk about Indian textile. We live in Surat, and we all know that Surat is famous for, yes, textiles and diamonds. More so for textiles. Now, before the age of industrialization in India, how the things were happening, especially the production activities. Let us see that in detail. Next slide, please. Fine. Now, as we know that the Silk Route is very much famous. If we move into the history of trading, the Silk Route is very much famous. India too used that. From India, through camels and through various livestock, the products were exported from India to elsewhere in the world. And this actually meant that the Indian trade was flourishing. At the same time, through the port cities like Hooghly and Surat, the two cities, Hooghly and Surat, hardly right now or currently developed as an export cities, but then these were the two cities which were, majority of the exports were done from these two cities. And systematically, Britishers actually suppressed these two cities. We have studied in Work Life Leisure chapter that how in 17th century, when Portuguese princess married to an English prince, how the Mumbai, that is Bombay then, was given in a dowry to the Britishers. And once Bombay was given in a dowry to the Britishers, the Britishers transferred the entire export trading from Surat to Bombay. And from there, Bombay never looked back. So basically, very systematically, these things were done. Yes. Next slide. Next. Okay. We have already seen this, that why Surat and Hooghly decayed, Bombay and Calcutta grew. Now, here, specifically, Britishers wanted their own thing to be developed. So they shifted from Surat to Bombay and from Hooghly to Calcutta. The new ones was an indicator of growth of colonial power. Now, they could have easily traded from Surat and Hooghly, but they wanted to show the world that they are introducing something of their own. And for this reason, the shifting was done. Next. Next, please. Okay, what happened to the weavers now? Earlier, what was the situation? The weavers, as we have seen in England, the weavers were giving contract to the merchants, and this was very much fine. But then, as the East India Company started proliferating in India, expanding its business in India, they got rights from the local kings, the regional kings and kingdoms, to have the sole monopoly of trading with Indian market, which meant that the merchants were now not in a position to do trade. The weavers were also forced to give their raw materials to the Britishers only. Here you can see the consolidation of East India Company after 1760 did not initially lead to a decline. But then, as the British, it was basically the growth of East India Company business in India and the decline of Indian merchants activities in India. Now, how they manage? The company specifically appointed appointed a gomasta, a paid servant known as gomasta. Now, what was the work of gomasta? Gomasta work was to supervise the production activity in the countryside. That was the first thing. And how they managed in the second way? They gave advances to the weavers. Now, weavers, as their income shrinked, because the merchants to whom they were earlier giving their orders were not able to maintain that order, because as we have seen earlier, that East India Company took the monopoly right of trading. So merchants were hardly able to export things from products out of India. So ultimately, weavers need to take order from the East India Company via gomasta. And this meant that they required money as well. So in a sense, by giving advances to the weavers, the East India Company and the gomastas forced them to grow the crops and do the various other activities to grow to get the cotton material. At times, there were clashes reported between gomasta and weavers regarding the price, regarding the material quality, and regarding the quantity of material, quantity of weaving cloth that was actually made by them. Because at times they were not satisfied. At times the gomasta and the East India Company were not satisfied with the material that was given by the weavers. Next, please. Here you can see one of the weaver doing the weaving activity. Next. Okay. Previous slide, please. Okay. Manchester comes to India. Now, the topic is a bit complicated. How can Manchester come to India? Literally, that doesn't mean that Manchester came to India, but how the Manchester products came to India. Once Henry Petullo, one of the English businessmen, told that Indian cotton textile will never be declining. The export of Indian cotton textile will never be declining. Reason it was a very fine quality product. But very systematically, the East India Company and the other private companies made it clear that the Indian textile declined. How it happened? We have already seen that weavers were hardly able to sell their products to any other person than the East India Company. But then at the same time, Manchester took the sole right, East India Company took the sole right to export their product to Indian market. At the same time, the weavers were not able to sell their products to any other merchants having the rights than the rights given by the East India Company or the British government, which means that Indians can now only and only export the raw material out of India. At the same time, they cannot have the production in India as well. So India actually became an exporter of raw material and the importer of the finished goods. So in both the cases, the Indian textile was completely controlled by the companies residing or located at Manchester. Here you can see, being glutted with Manchester imports produced by machines at lower cost. Indian products were handmade, whereas Manchester products were machine made. And as they were machine made, they were cheaper in price. So they were in great demand in Indian market. People started purchasing those products manufactured in Manchester, in those companies, rather than purchasing Indian products. At a very later stage, somewhere in 1920s, we will see in one of the chapter of nationalism in India, this year only, that during the non-cooperation movement, how Gandhiji systematically advocated the use of Indian products. This is the reason why he advocated, why he requested people to use the Indian products instead of British-made products. Next, please. Now here you can see they could not get sufficient supply of raw cotton. Why they could not get a sufficient supply? Now who are they over here? The Indian merchants. They were not able to, as we already seen again and again, that the entire supply was given to the British companies through Gumasta. Specifically, when American Civil War broke out, the raw cotton which was supplied by America to Britain was stopped. So Britain ultimately turned to India to get the raw cotton. So whatever quantity and quality of material was hardly given to Indian merchants, even that was stopped all together. Next slide, please. Here you can see how the industries are working today. So in the next chapter, in the next topic, we will see that how India's industrial growth took place. It's a very unique story. We'll see in the next class. Thank you and have a nice day.